Welcome to our Good Friday Reflections. We will slow down and pause after the events of the day as we begin the Easter weekend. We have just been reminded that the King we serve came as a helpless babe. He came to be a servant King. He came to show us that we need to be servant people. So we join together in an old Easter hymn, The Old Rugged Cross. Let us sing these words as if they were afresh and new, so their hearts will be open to receive the message that God has for us tonight. Let's sing.
Tremble.
As we pray, let us think of fellow Christians in Ukraine, reflecting on a holy week while living under the threat of war must be challenging. Puts a lot of things for us into perspective. Let's pray. Dear Lord, as we think of the events of Holy Week and what today means for all Christians around the world, from every tribe and nation, we ask for your love and healing, your power and strength to flow amongst us in such times as these. Grant us the wisdom to reflect on the past so that we can live for the future, a future grounded in the true Easter message. Take this time of peaceful contemplation that we will share to enrich our fellowship. We ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen indeed. We're now going to be blessed to listen to the Songsters. A lovely song, Unlimited Love.
Oh,
We're going to share together some readings as we journey to the cross on this Good Friday evening. These will be interspersed with songs and music to aid our reflection. We commence with the first two readings, and then we continue by joining in with "There is a green hill far away." Jesus is arrested. So Judas came to the garden, guiding a detachment of soldiers and some officials from the chief priests and Pharisees. They were carrying torches, lanterns, and weapons. Jesus, knowing all that was going to happen to him, went out and asked them, "Who is it you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "I am he," Jesus said, and Judas the traitor was standing there with them. When Jesus said, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "Who is it you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they said. Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. If you're looking for me, then let these people go." This happened so that the words he had spoken would be fulfilled: "I have not lost one of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his right ear. Jesus commanded Peter, "Put your sword away. Shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me?" Peter's denial. Simon Peter and the other disciples were following Jesus. Because this disciple was known to the high priest, he went in with Jesus into the high priest's courtyard. But Peter had to wait outside at the door. The other disciple, who was known to the high priest, came back, spoke to the servant girl on duty there, and brought Peter in. "You aren't one of this man's disciples too, are you?" she asked Peter. He replied, "I am not." It was cold, and the servants and the officials stood around a fire they had made to keep warm. Peter was also standing there warming himself. Meanwhile, Simon Peter was still standing there warming himself. So they asked him, "You aren't one of the disciples too, are you?" He denied it, saying, "I am not." One of the high priest's servants, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, challenged him, "Didn't I see you with him in the garden?" Again, Peter denied it. And at that moment, the cock began to crow.
Thank you.
Jesus before Pilate. Then the Jewish leaders took Jesus from Caiaphas to the palace of the Roman governor. By now it was early morning, and to avoid ceremonial uncleanliness, they did not enter the palace, because they wanted to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and asked, "What charges are you bringing against this man?" "If he were not a criminal," they replied, "we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said, "Take him yourself and judge him by your own law." "But we have no right to execute anyone," they objected. This took place to fulfill what Jesus had said about the kind of death he was going to die. Pilate then went back inside the palace, summoned Jesus and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "Is that your own idea," Jesus said, "or did others talk to you about me?" "Am I a Jew?" Pilate replied. "Your own people and chief priests handed you over to me. What is it you have done?" Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jewish leaders. But now my kingdom is from another place." "You are a king then," said Pilate. Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. In fact, the reason I was born and came into the world was to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." "What is truth?" retorted Pilate. With this, he went out again to the Jews, gathered there, and said, "I find no basis for a charge against him, but it is your custom for me to release to you one prisoner at the time of the Passover. Do you want me to release the king of the Jews?" And they shouted back, "No, not him. Give us Barabbas." Now Barabbas had taken part in an uprising.
Cross. It was meant to horrify the world. It was meant for humiliation. It was meant to last for days. It was meant for slow asphyxiation. It was meant to prolong torture. It was the Roman soldier's job. It was meant to be used by Caesar, but instead, it was used by God. It was meant to stop a movement, but instead, it became the way. It was meant to act on fear, but instead, it awakened faith. It was meant to be vicious and violent, but instead, it became our peace. It was meant to uproot hope, but instead, it became the seed. It was meant to punish captives, but instead, it unleashed freedom. It was meant to build up Rome, but instead, it built God's kingdom. It was meant to discourage rebels. It was meant to stop insurrection. It was meant to put down Jesus, but instead, it set up his resurrection. It was meant to jeer and mock him, but instead it was his glory. It was meant to erase a chapter, but instead it became the story. It was meant to hold up convicts, but instead it raised up a king. It was meant to shut our mouth, but instead it's why we sing. It was meant to be a judgment, but instead it became our mercy. It's why the song of heaven is the Lamb. The Lamb is worthy. It was meant to kill an enemy, crush dissenters and diversion, but instead it became the banner of God's love for every person. It was meant to be appalling, nailing hands and feet to wood. It was meant to be used for evil, but instead it was used for good. It was meant to be a symbol of God's assassination, but instead, it became the symbol of Jesus' invitation. Come to the cross. Instead of sin and stain, you are meant to be made clean. Instead of being forgotten, you are meant to know your sin. Instead of being ashamed, you can leave behind your guilt. Instead of feeling empty, you were meant to be fulfilled. Instead of being broken, you are meant to be made whole. Here, Calvary is calling. It beckons you. Behold, come to the cross. Instead of being an accident, you have a purpose and a plan. Instead of being abandoned, you were chosen by His hand. For all who've said, I can't, God has said, I can. No matter what you've done, the invitation stands. Come to the cross. Instead of being doubtful, you are meant to know your Father. You are meant to be His son, and you are meant to be His daughter. You were cherished from the start. You were always in the picture. Instead of being a victim, you were meant to be a victor. The result of Jesus' blood, salvation has arrived. Instead of being dead, you are meant to be alive. The cross, it was meant to signal death, but instead, it's a sign of living. It was meant to be the end, but instead, it's our beginning.
Jesus sentenced to be crucified. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. The soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head. They clothed him in a purple robe and went up to him again and again, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they slapped him in the face. Once more Pilate came out and said to the Jews gathered there, "Look, I am bringing him out to you. I found no basis of the charge against him." When Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." As soon as the chief priests and the officials saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify!" But Pilate answered, "You take him and crucify him. As for me, I found no basis for the charge against him." The Jewish leaders insisted, "We have a law, and according to the law he must die because he claimed to be the Son of God." When Pilate heard this, he was even more afraid, and went back inside the palace. "Where do you come from?" he asked Jesus. But Jesus gave him no answer. "Do you refuse to speak to me?" Pilate said. "Don't you realize I have power either to free you or crucify you?" Jesus answered, "You would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to set Jesus free, but the Jewish leaders kept shouting, "If you let this man go, you are no friend of Caesar. Anyone who claims to be a king opposes Caesar." When Pilate heard this, he brought Jesus out and sat him down on the judge's seat at a place known as the Stone Pavement. It was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about noon. "Here is your king," Pilate said to the Jews. But they shouted, "Take him away, take him away. Crucify him." "Shall I crucify your king?" Pilate asked. "We have no king but Caesar," the chief priests answered. Finally, Pilate handed him over to them to be crucified.
Thank you.
the crucifixion of Jesus. So the soldiers took charge of Jesus. Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull, where they crucified him with two others, one on each side and Jesus in the middle. Pilate had a notice prepared and fastened to the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this sign, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and a sign was written in Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. The chief priests of the Jews protested to Pilate, "Do not write the King of the Jews, but that this man claimed to be King of the Jews." Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers crucified Jesus, they took his clothes, divided them into four shares, one for each of them. With the undergarment remaining, this garment was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. "Let's not tear it," they said to one another. "Let's decide by lot who will get it." This happened so that the scriptures might be fulfilled. That said, "They divided my clothes among them. They cast lots for my garments." So this is what the soldiers did.
Thank you.
the death of Jesus. Later, knowing that everything had now been finished and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there. They soaked a sponge in it and put the sponge on a stalk of a hyssop plant and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." And with that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Now it was the day of preparation, and the next day was to be a special Sabbath. Because the Jewish leaders did not want their bodies left on the crosses during the Sabbath, they asked Pilate to have the legs broken and the bodies taken down. The soldiers therefore came and broke the legs of the first man who had been crucified with Jesus and those of the other. But when they came to Jesus, they found he was already dead. They did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced Jesus' side with a spear, bringing a sudden flow of blood and water. The man who saw it was given testimony, and his testimony is true. He knows that he tells the truth, and he testifies so, so that you may believe. These things happened so that the scripture would be fulfilled. Not one of his bones will be broken. And as another scripture says, they will look on the one they have pierced.
That the Lord of all the earth would care to know my name, would care to feel my hurt. Who am I that the bright and morning star would choose to light the way for my ever wandering heart? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm you catch me when I'm falling, and you told me who I am. I am yours. I am yours. Who am I that the eyes that see my sin would look on me that calm the sea, would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. Here today and gone tomorrow.
At the weekly evening meal at the Briary last week, the subject of Easter came up. Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, etc. One of the residents asked what that was all about. I explained simply, I thought, but then realised he had no idea or concept of Easter at all. And when he realised what happened on that Friday, he asked, "So why do you call it good? He was killed." Again, I tried to explain by keeping it very simple. However, this conversation did make me think. We know what came after Friday, today. We know that 3 days later, the deep magic, as C.S. Lewis calls it, was revealed and death was defeated. We know that, and we can look back in history and see the effects of that. But the followers of Jesus at the time, the disciples, the women that were often referred to, and even the crowds must have been at their wits' end, for they didn't know. I wonder what was going on in their minds. Could they sleep? Did they want to sleep? How long did they look on the cross on a hill? From near or from afar? Did they glance back and shake their heads in despair, in fear, in confusion? I guess probably all of these and probably others, perhaps over and over again. I guess it was likely that they went into survival mode and see what a new day brings. How long, I wonder, did the Sabbath on that Saturday seem to last? Waiting for Sunday to whatever came next. As I say, we know to call it Good Friday, but I wonder what they called it. What was its first name? After all, my friend at the Priory said he was killed. My answer for us today, and for him, is simple. It's Friday, but Sundays are coming, and that's where the hope rests. Last night, we watched Jesus Christ Superstar, a massive production, great music and some interesting messages. But still, to me, it's one fall, draw, is that it finishes with the crucifixion. So perhaps the only day to show it would be Thursday or today, because then we'd know, we know what comes next. We can call it a good musical because we know what happens on Sunday. It's a Friday, but Sundays are coming.
Oh,
We will finish today with the lovely words, "Before the throne of God above, I have a strong, a perfect plea." As we look on the first glimpse of Easter Sunday in the distance, but let us sing now. Hallelujah. Amen. And see you on Sunday. Thank you.